what's up, everybody? Kind of bring this down a little bit. I started just about a minute. It's Farkle Friday. I took last week off, so we're back again today. The day got a little busy for me last Friday. I was busy training Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu with a buddy. So, Grim, taking the sting out of my surprise, what made you possibly think today would be about Back to the Future? Could it be the title of today's Farkle Friday? It might very well be. What's going on, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah, we're going to do a little Farkle Friday. This is actually a viewer request that I've been putting off for a while. Not because I didn't want to. I actually really wanted to. I just kind of needed to sit down and kind of like organize myself. So, first of all, I hope everyone is doing well. Hope everyone is safe and enjoying the weather and happy. We use that phrase a lot now in the post-pandemic. I hope everyone's safe. I'm like, I think everyone's pretty much safe now, especially if you've gotten the vaccine. So it's more just like, I hope everyone's enjoying life and kind of doing cool things, because we I'm personally ready for us to start doing cool things. Big surprise in joking about this. Right now, this is just the only little bit of, not even political, but just like non-music thing. Right in my area of the world, just outside of Philadelphia, we're having a good run of COVID terror. Like, it's just tearing through a bunch of schools right now. So they're you know, kind of cautioning about that stuff. And once again, there's no hospitalizations because these kids are all vaccinated. They're all like 15 years old, so they're fine. They're all getting bad colds. But it's bummer. Like, the kids are going home in droves because it's happening. Every so often, it just runs through the community. So it is what it is, you know? I would love to. Scott's hilarious, and I am too, because we both, he got Corona, then got the vaccine, then got it again. Am I right with that, Scott? And then I got vaccinated and got it, and I got the Pfizer, which is a super double one. So, and Lazar, can you do a World of Warcraft next week? Oh my God, yes. And Lazar, thank you for that request, and I'll tell you why. Because the next one I was going to do, which was tying into the two projects I'm working on, was fantasy music. And I'm building my references, and I wanted to do more video game music. I was actually gonna do JRPG music today, but, thanks, sorry about that. It's my air conditioner, sorry. There we go. Sorry about that. It's 92 degrees here, so it's a little background noise. Sorry about that. I was going to do one on JRPG music because I'm working on trying to do some JRPG stuff for one of my albums, but I'm finding that more and more I'm sounding more and more like kind of American fantasy, which tied into why I was listening to some Alan Silvestri, which tied into when Scott asked me to do this today. The point is, I want to do a couple of Farkle Fridays on fantasy music, and one of them is going to be probably film and TV fantasy music, and one's going to be video game fantasy music. And it's like World of Warcraft, Wrath of the Lich King, Legion, you know, the Burning Crusade. Like, these are like super, super good dark fantasy. So Lazar, you will definitely getting, we'll definitely doing a World of Warcraft Farkle Friday, like fairly organized in the next couple of weeks. Definitely. How's that sound? Is that good stuff? So speaking of good stuff, let's listen to some good stuff. So today we're going to be talking about Alan Silvestri, and we're going to be listening to some of his stuff. We're going to be parsing out some of the things that he does, trying to pick up some of his tricks, and, you know, just kind of enjoying some of his more famous, but some of his lesser known, but very compositionally iconic scores. And yeah, that's pretty much it. So let me open up a little notepad. We'll do a little bit of chatting about that kind of stuff. And of course, as always, feel free to post any questions, any comments, any originally inappropriate jokes in the chat window. I've got my thing open. Never likes it. Moving on, time for World of Warcraft. Well, that's because you haven't, see, here's the question is like, what have you heard from him, right? So let's talk about him a little bit. And as we do this, let me get my, I've been playing with some of my new keyboards here. I just got the Roland SoundClouds. I've got this like, oh, I got all that fun stuff to play with. So we're gonna have a good time with this. So let's talk about Alan Silvestri. Alan Silvestri came out of my neck of the woods. He was from the East Coast. He came out of Teaneck, New Jersey, and went to Berklee College of Music. So he had a background in jazz and kind of pop arranging. He started old school. He went to LA and started on the low budget films. A little bit of trivia. His first film score was a direct to cable film. No, excuse me, direct to, I think it was direct to video, called The Doberman Gang. And it had an old Fred Astaire OST. And if you listen here, I'm going to move this over to the main screen. Okay. So you can see over here, this is actually some of the music that this is Alan's very first bit of music. So you can totally hear Alan came up in the 70s, and it's awesome. So check it out here. Think those kids don't know what dumb dog. Salad stuff, man. All right, so as groovy as this is, and it's totally groovy, what are some of these we're already starting to see? Well, first of all, Alan's got a real strong sense of rhythm, okay? Oh, was Austin talking about him, Austin Winter was talking about him a little bit ago on his website? Cool. Let me see if I can find, the entire movie's up here. I want to play one thing, because already we're starting to see what Alan's preferences are. So first, Alan is a very rhythmic composer. I think he was a guitar player, but you can already see he gravitates to rhythm as opposed to like textural stuff. He likes that kind of repeated hot, fast pulse, which we're going to see in his later orchestral scores. Secondly, like Jerry Goldsmith, because he came up through television, he's using a lot of the TV instruments. So these kind of these piano and octaves, right? That kind of stuff, right? This is going to show up later on in his stuff. All right, so let's even just skip around and listen to some of the stuff.
Turn.
No. Wow, okay. We're not going to show porn here. So we can find, here's that scene.
Happen to notice it.
Yeah, he likes his shaker, doesn't he? Now, what we just heard there, something kind of interesting. When Alan says something, he'll oftentimes repeat it in a different register. He'll be like, ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba-da, ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba-da. He likes to do that because he gets to stretch his idea out, okay? For those of you who have studied with me and have heard some of my stuff, you wonder where I got this idea from. It's from Alan. So let's take a listen here. Here's a great example of that. You can hear this little lick in the brass that's then repeated in the flute. These are very common things. Now, you might say, yeah, well, other people do it. Yeah, but Alan does it very obviously, where he's constantly like giving space for it. He's like, here it is in the brass, here it is in the strings, you know? And so I'm loving it. Yeah. So boy, this is a really crappy movie. It's real.
It is.
Hold on just a sec. I gotta check with Sarah as to why the dogs are losing it, because they're just... So the reason that was kind of interesting was this led to him getting his first TV show, which I think was instrumental in getting his speed up, which was Chips. And if you listen, people don't know this, Alan Silvestri wrote the Chips theme song, which if you've not listened to, is so fantastic. So once again, high sense of rhythm. So that was kind of cool. That was actually Alan's big, Alan's big break. And if you listen, oh my God, this might actually be in Spotify, but if not, let's listen to some cues that are like some of the things that he was doing in that television, because this is going to inform what happened when he transferred into film, you know? Yeah, Scott's like, dude, what are you doing to those trumpet players? It's like, no, man, we eat those things for breakfast. Yeah, it's totally true. All right, let me put this down here. Actually, I've got a pretty good setup here, actually. We've got a nice audio. Oh, Ripley's losing her shit because we had a thunderstorm and she gets really nervous about that stuff. Let's go to, let's get to one of these ones here. Let's listen to, like, just a random cue and just hear if we can start to hear Alan's tendencies and traits, because that's actually a lot of fun. This is a remake of this. No. It's a lot of disco. Dude, this shit slaps, man. God, I love 70s television. Why would you not? I've actually got a Farkle Friday idea that I've been working on for the choir. For those of you who know the sensitive sides of Back to the Future, like that kind of sound. Da-da. This kind of. So also we've seen now twice, Alan's playing this game where he's playing the 1 flat 7 thing, where he's just like, just moving down a whole step back and forth as a comp. Which is again, if we think about how composers love, yeah, dude. Hold on a sec. Time for me to lock on this bad boy here. I've been playing with. Let me get this going. That's for you. That's for you, Scott. So you know how composers tend to have harmonic progressions they like. Like Bernard Herrmann tended to like. Like a minor third relation, and Hans Zimmer likes the minor 1 to flat 6, right? Like that. Alan's already shown he likes this kind of flat 7 modal thing, right? Kind of right? And that's kind of showing up here. Now, the other thing is, he's not afraid to be a little sensitive and sweet, which shows up in cues like this later on. And we're going to get to his movie stuff, you know? Here we go. So this kind of stuff. I think it's this one. 4x4, let me check and see if it is. This kind of sweet, sensitive stuff. Right? he's not afraid to do these very sweet, beautiful little harmonies. And by the way, all this stuff that he's doing is like classic. It's a 251. It's all classic jazz stuff here. Look, that literally that last chord relationship was literally an A minor 7 over D to a G, which is a classic 2/5 as a hybrid chord. Yeah, he really does it. Oh, you know the real what he did? It was when George actually gives Lorraine the kiss. Yeah, here it is. This is when he goes, "Are you okay?" And she gives him her hand. Right? He's just absolutely maudlin, and it's beautiful. So, we're seeing little hits of that already in this, you know? Let's see what else we can find here. Oh, I think it's... Hell yeah, man. If you've not fallen in love with 60s and 70s television music, you are missing something, because between, like, Streets of San Francisco, Kojak, you know, Heart to Heart... You know, all that shit, like, it's fantastic, man. It's all this shit. It's all, like, the disco ensemble. All right. Did you see what he just did there? Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Says it again. Ba-da-da-da-da. These are the kind of stretching mechanics that, Alan does to take his idea and give it more life. And it's simple and it's compartmentalized. It's like 2 bars, 4 bars. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think this is one of these guilty pleasures. I don't know. Scott, you and I are similar in age. So we kind of grew up on this stuff. There's a guilty pleasure to this, I think, of like, I shouldn't like this, but I really do because it's just so unapologetically fun, you know? It is unapologetically a good time, and everybody's enjoying themselves, and nobody really cares. I just spilled some Ardbeg. Ooh, that's on me. Today's experimental drink, I got an Ardbeg Suite, S-U-I-T-E, of samplers, and this is a 5-year scotch. Ardbeg is heavy on the peat. Heavy on the peat. Yeah. Ooh, that's good. That's really good. Who referred me to Ardbeg? Was it Phil? I don't know. I'm all over the place today. All right, so let's move on here because we're starting to get Alan's thing. So now we know that Alan likes the more sweet romantic stuff, but also he likes these kind of quick little bite-sized themes that he kind of says over and over again in different registers and different instruments. What's up, Mike C? Ardbeg 10 is, I have a bottle downstairs. I got it as a present for one of my students when he finished his master's. This particular suite that I got was 3 bottles. One was Ardbeg 5, one was Ardbeg 10, and one was Ardbeg Ona or Noah or something like that. I don't know. Ardbeg 5 is nice. I mean, you can tell it's the same kind of Ardbeg as the 10, but it doesn't have nearly as much smoke because it doesn't have 5 years of the maturing. But it's good. Yeah, I'm with you, man. Ardbeg 10 is fantastic. I can't believe how good it is. So let's now think about what happens now that Alan starts. Now we're going to do a little bit of a dodge here because y'all think, oh, it's going to Back to the Future. We'll get there. But I believe, let's take a look here. Before Back to the Future, let's see what his films were here. Where is Back to the Future? Oh, was that first? He actually did that first? So before he did Back to the Future, he did something called Romancing the Stone. And I'm all sorts of prep for this. You get what you pay for. And what we see in Romancing the Stone is Alan's pop sensibilities. Right, he's got that beautiful, that kind of really good, gee, that thing is freaking just drowning in verb. Let me actually get something that actually might actually work. Like that. And when you hear that, you can hear that Alan is now bringing his TV scoring sensibilities and his jazz pop sensibilities into the big screen. And it just happened to coincide. This is one of these chicken and the egg things where it's like, you know, did Alan and other people like that make the sound of the 80s because they brought their 70s sensibilities, or did the 80s bring out this kind of friendly pop sound? Let's look here. Listen. So right off the bat, look what we're doing with this. Have a great day, Scott. Take care, man. Oh, yeah, yeah. Even though Randall's handle is Randall Scott King, he goes by his middle name. So not a big deal. I was just going to say, like as you're hanging out with him, he's like, I'm a Scott dude. So I all right. So right off the bat, 1-4. Yeah. Oh yeah. Father of the Bride. Oh, he's dripping with this. Just like he's real. Cause everyone thinks of him as like he's got this weird little duality because he can do the real sweet, sensitive family stuff, which we're going to get to. But yeah. This literally is Jazz 101. It's G. G with the B. C sus 2. And then it's literally circle of fifths. B minor. B minor. A minor. You know, C over D. Guess what we're listening to? I know. Say hi to everybody. Kate's here. I know. It's the, this is really good stuff. All the modulation, dude. Up the gangsters high. Still firmly in pop mentality, you know? Oh, yeah, hold on a second. I got a question for the Nugget.
Do we have the...
I believe so. Go check it. Take a look. I think we do, it's Uncle Homie's, but you can totally borrow. Yeah, yeah.
Is it up here, right?
Yeah, yeah. Are you meeting D&D guys today?
No, I just...
If not, I can get it for you. I have that. Sorry. We have to help Kate with D&D stuff. Check both and pull it out too.
All
right, cool. I'm pretty sure we have Christmas draw here somewhere. If not, I can put an order in because I want to get it. D&D stuff, very important stuff. Yeah. Is Kate Grimm was asking? Is Kate interested in composing? She's a musician. She's got her own band.
We wrote a song. Me and my friend wrote a song, two friends.
Right, so she's got her own thing going. Like, I help her out with a couple chords here and there, but, like, in terms of, like, scoring for film and video games, she's like, nah. She's
a little hard to run.
Yeah, did you get it?
She's a hard to run.
I don't know, but it's undead. Do you want any more undead?
Well, I'm not going to be a player, so.
You're going to DM it?
I'm going to borrow this.
I recommend,
I don't want to do
it. No. I recommend checking that one out, and then I recommend, I have... somewhere downstairs. Oh, I have Descent into Avernus, which is the hell one with the demons and the devils. That's like, it's
this
like
is
mad
pirates.
Well, yeah, that was supposed to be good too. That was okay. Good. Oh, go for it. Yeah, I'm just saying, if you don't want to do that, you do demons and devils.
It.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay.
D&D. Yeah, we're like, I ran an adventure for her and we're one of her best friends for years, and we're gonna run another one. Oh, no kidding.
It was just a YouTube series. And voice acting. It was Travis.
Wow.
And they didn't recognize him at all.
They're really doing well with their career. That's
they
awesome.
Feel like a YouTube
well, they are professional VO actors. They can do crazy accents and stuff, right?
No, they weren't even doing accents. They just didn't recognize their voices.
Oh, it's funny. Yeah, go check that out.
Bye-bye.
And if you don't like that one, check out The Descent into Avernus. I have that one. So what those are, we're all over the place. Well, Lazar, the funny thing you were mentioning was that's kind of one of my projects is like writing music that would either accompany role-playing games or try to evoke the imagery of role-playing games. And I'm trying to figure out how to do that because it's not video game music. It's not movie music, but it's not just ambient, you know, drone music. It's like trying to tell a D&D adventure without the D&D adventure. And that, why make life easy for myself? Because that's what I do. So that's kind of what this, I've been mulling about for the last 6 months. You know, I just don't know how to do it yet, though. Which is where I'm getting into fantasy stuff, because I'm trying to think, well, fantasy stuff that tells stories, but also video game fantasy music tells moods, which you have to do both. So Grim, these are pre-made adventures. Yeah. Yeah, it's like a real-life soundtrack. Exactly. Real-life storytelling. So these are pre-made adventures. She's apparently Dungeon Master in her first session. She'll be fine. She's been playing since she's been 9 years old, and she's 16, so she knows what she's doing. What's going on, everybody? So I want to check out one more thing here before we jump into the end titles, because the end titles are fantastic. Let's look at Alan with his action music this early in the game. So here's the Hotel Escape. Oh, look. He's got fast percussion. All right, let's see what he does. Oh, look, he's using the piano as a functional instrument. We're going to see this in about 10 minutes, right? It's like he's got his habits, right? Right. Something like that. Yeah. Says it twice, da 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 da, in the French horn, and then he says it again in the trumpet. This is how he's stretching his ideas, and he's not moved off the harmonies, right? Right. Look, I mean, and boy, by the way, he's playing flat 6-1, so he's in like pop 80s world. Well, Lazar, it's not an unpopular opinion. It's totally fine. It was a prodigy of the time. It was back when you kept costs down by using those electronic kits in the 80s. Nowadays, you keep costs down by loading Heaviosity, Evolve, and Damage and all those kind of composery things. So that was just that of the times. It's definitely a dated sound. I don't think they were in love with it. I think they were like, yeah, we got to get this movie scored and we don't have a huge budget. And the composer came in and was like, well, I'll just use my Roland whatever or my Simmons drums and Lynn drums. And they're like, yeah, you know, okay, we'll just do that, which is fine. Yeah, and Kyle's right. It's like it has to be done musically and tastefully. But we're starting to see the beginning of Alan's compositional traits, because they're going to come into fruition in the next one we're going to look at. And by the way, you just have to listen to the end titles, because the end titles are so good. It's so happy. Like, I love that Alan is fundamentally a happy composer. For a guy? It's like he's just such a happy composer. Dude, that kick drum is fucking monstrous. The 80s. for those of you who remember and who know Mike Furta, if like you don't hear Mike's influence from Alan, it's like you're not listening. Like it's, and I mean that in the best possible way. I think Mike can do this 80s pop fusion thing, jazz, like you wouldn't believe, you know? So why is this so the Kyle's on point with this. Dude, this is great, man. But check this out. Here's the last component of the puzzle. So now he's seen he has these simple little quick ideas that he repeats over and over again, but he's moving around harmonically. We see that he likes the flat seven, which shows up in his later stuff. It shows up in his later fantasy scores. And we've seen that this is the last part of the puzzle. He can sit on a vamp for a while. Cause that thing that the like he sat there for like a minute. Like I would have been like killing myself as an ADD composer. I'd be like, I gotta move, I gotta get off this. I've been sitting on the G and the C. He's like, nah, we'll just sit, we'll vamp for a while. Why is that important? Because maybe when he actually started to get gigs with a full score, he was comfortable with just sitting on the vamp, right? And so maybe now all of a sudden, and we get to hear, and let's look at how long he sits on this super good vamp, which has his tropes, right? Ready? Shakers, fast rhythmic percussive elements. Right? And here's his main idea. Right? Now watch, he repeats the same thing, he says it again, but now he does it in another octave, because remember, that's what Alan does. He'll say it once in one register, and once in another register, sucking up a ton of time and still... That's an octave, right? He's saying the same thing, he's just added octave. Here's the next part. Listen to this. Dun, 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 dun. Everyone's like, oh, it's the Jaws theme. No, no, no. We've already found out Alan starts to like little tiny ideas that you can repeat over and over again. We've already talked about this, right? But look, it's kind of... So here is the last component of this as Alan starts to... delve into more full orchestral stuff, which is he gets his big sound by layering octaves and families. So what Alan will do, I may have to go to Sibelius for this. Alan will, and he'll build this as an orchestral stack this way. This is a little, this saved my butt in Vampires on a Boat. So what he'll do is he'll do a lick. Let's say we're doing, kind of like a. Let's see, doing that. So he's going like G minor to B flat to D to F, all in minor, right? What he'll do is he'll do the first two in the low brass. I'll actually do it really slow so I can actually do it. Okay. Right? Then, what he'll do is he'll gradually add higher instruments in the orchestration. And ah, shoot. Get it right because there's no click. Now, besides that, I screwed this whole thing up. Can you see how by adding octaves, I'm slowly creating a larger and fuller sound? Do you see how, like, by doing this, by adding the octaves, this is how Alan starts to get that huge sound? And this, by the way, is if you want to figure out how the hell to write for woodwinds, this is how you do it. You're like, oh, what are the three trumpets doing? Let me double that an octave below with the clarinets. Let me double it at pitch with the flutes. Now I'm creating something big, and I'm just adding octaves. So it's, so it's real. So now we're starting to see Alan, now we haven't talked about it. Go for it, Lazar. Piano, he loves his piano. So, even with that big burly sound, we're seeing Alan's traits from television starting to show up. The last component, which we'll deal with later, is Alan's brass writing, which is really, really good and surprisingly simple when you look at the score. You're like, let me find where the cue is. Yeah, like here. How'd you get that huge sound? Let's blow it up here. Here's the boom. So this is trumpets and there's horns. The horns aren't even doing anything. Let's look at what the brass is doing. The brass is octave E's. Let me get over to a piano so you can hear it. It's just so right, cool. Fucking rolling pianos are awesome. So look what it is. It's make sure I've got it right. It's an E, a C sharp, and a G. So it's right. And then he's got a is it in B flat? So it literally is. I think it's actually in concert score. Yeah. Yes, it. Yeah, there's a lot of Stravinsky with this. So literally it is a diminished triad blown out into open position. And then it is a diminished triad just planing up. So Alan does a lot of triadic brass writing. And he doubles it note for note up and below octaves. If it's too low in the trombones, he'll make it open, meaning he'll just space it out. So instead of which is very muddy, he'll do an open position. So This is actually a really cut, and look, that same gesture, he's doubling an octave above in the winds. So that's how we start to get that big full sound. It's simple, and Kyle, this is how we can sketch in four staves, because you could just write that chord stack on one staff and then put a note to yourself, double with winds, 8 VA. And you know in your head, you're like, I'm going to write in the trumpets and I'm going to double with the flutes an octave above, right? This is a very Silvestri sound. And I used it in, which we're not going to go into because you should hear Alan not listen to me. In Vampires on a Boat, that's how I do this stuff. I would go. And I would just add octaves as the phrase moved and it just whoosh, makes it big. Yeah, Kyle and I just finished an orchestration class together, an orchestration breakdown, and I literally was talking about this. I was like, this is exactly how you get the big sound. You've got your functional voice leading in your sketch, and you look at it and go, yeah, I'm hearing that in trumpets, but if I want it bigger, I'll put it an octave below in clarinets or an octave above in flutes in addition, and you get... Yeah, dude, Woodwinds are the last pick on the kickball team, right? It's like, just go play with the trumpets are playing. Who cares? I don't want the woodwinds on my dodgeball team. I'd rather play a man down. So now that, here's the final component of this. Where is he getting this idea from? Because it's already 3:18, I want to listen to a lot more cool stuff. Alan is using one of the most famous scales in jazz, which is the octatonic scale, or the diminished scale, whatever you want to call it. It's the same thing, which is half step, whole step, half step, whole step, half step, whole step, half step, whole step. And it gives you this really great, that you can use it melodically. Like the main line is literally from the octatonic scale. And this little lick are the first three notes of the octatonic scale. So it's, you know, there it is. But here's why this is cool. If you build triads from the octatonic scale, the way the octatonic scale works is you can build majors and minor triads, minor thirds apart. So you can have an A minor, E major, G minor, B flat major, B flat minor, and C sharp minor, C sharp major. And Alan in the 80s beats the shit out of this. So how many times have you heard this thing where he'll be doing like... As a matter of fact, let's hear that. Let's do it right now. All that right there. All that was literally two chords of tritone apart, which are in the octatonic scale. He went like A minor to B flat. Let me see if I can find. I think it's the truck. No, it's the. By the way, we hear these little gestures. Like do these little tiny little two bar, like two note little things. And look, fast percussion, because Alan likes fast percussion. Let me find the one that... Here it is. Hear that? He went from a G minor to an E minor. Right there it is. To E minor, there it is. Minor thirds apart. When you lose the octatonic scale, you gain access to two chord relationships, chords of minor third apart and chords of tritone apart. And look, he said it twice. I mean, he literally just said it one time with the English horn. And then he does it with the strings. Like, we're not even at Back to the Future yet, and we're already seeing he's doing this shit over and over again. This is not hard to figure out, right? Let's go to my last favorite one before we go to the one of his seminal 80s scores. Right here, look at this. Now, let's take this octatonic scale and motion by minor thirds and put it in a rhythmic context, which is so cool. It's like, literally he's moving minor thirds here the whole time through with brass. scale. They're all, they're something like this. It's like, something like that. It's just, three chords that are just all the octatonic scale. The octatonic scale, Kyle, you and I will need to go over. It's actually in the equilibrium system. It's called scale 21. But we'll go over it. It is one of the several default scales you use if you want to do 80s style action music. Like, it's Alan uses it all the time. So you're saying, oh, is it mixolydian with the flat 7? Well, the flats, no, it's not that. It's its own scale. It is literally, I'll tell it to Kyle, in equal interval systems, it's E1 plus E2. So you start on a note, E1 plus E2, E1, E2, E1, E2, E1, E2, E1, E2. Yeah. And it gives you, and once you start building triads, it's like you can just do. To me, it gives mystery. Like I was using it all the time in Vampires on a Boat, where they're like, there's something in the ship. It doesn't have a heat signature, but it's using oxygen. And you know, I'd be like. That kind of stuff. It was a lot of fun. But notice Alan's writing Burly Burly Brass with this. So you can take these chords that are a minor third. If you put them in a staccato patch, listen to how this. That's Alan right there. That is Predator. Right, and then if you double in octaves like this, I mean, it's huge, right? It's a ginormous sound. Ginormous points for that. So now Alan gets his Star Wars. It's knowing what. So now check this out. Octatonic gives you chords minor third apart. But if you skip the minor third and you get tritones, you get the sci-fi sound. But you know what you also get? You get. That's literally what Alan did for all of Back to the Future. It is literally, and if you look at Back to the Future, and if you've not gotten this from Omni, shame on you, because it is freaking like just ridiculous. That's what he's doing. He's literally here. Let's go take a listen. The stuff that he's doing, and we're gonna get to some of his later stuff. We gotta look at this Avengers stuff and everything. I got a lot of his shit. You disintegrated Einstein. Look, there's Alan. Let's say it multiple times in different octaves, because we're gonna just milk the shit out of it. Yeah. Look, these little jet puppa depa depa. Right? Like, this is Alan. He likes these little short licks that he can just kind of use over and over again. All right, now, I don't have the score for this. Like, I do, but it's here. But his relationships there are tritones. It's like, sounds like somebody else we know, Danny Elfman, because this all came from Bernard Herrmann, who Alan Silvestri knows very well, because he did a Bernard Herrmann pastiche called What Lies Beneath. So we're starting to see now where this is all coming from. Omni Music Publishing is a company that does licensed, correct to the note, publishings of film scores. So I've got almost all of them. Basic Instinct, Batman, The Matrix, Ghostbusters, Star Trek The Motion Picture, Silverado, Total Recall, Willow, Krull, Back to the Future. There's a British company called Chris Siddle Music that they do it as well. He did Aliens, I got that. He did Conan the Barbarian. Yeah, man, they're like, yeah, no, you do. Like, these things are just like I just buy them. I don't care. Like, because I want them. They're so good. So, let's repeat it. And that sound there, how does he get that sound? He's layering the same lick on multiple instruments. So, So this sound, that thing, if you go and look at the score, that lick which on a sketch would just be the lick, is being played by like electric piano, celeste, harp, piano, probably like a synth. So these are how Alan gets that big sound. He's got that production mindset of like layer the idea across multiple instruments. What's up, Mike? Dude, I'll tell you something. First of all, Kyle, I'm so sorry, dude, because yeah, like you're getting money spent. But you know there's a link that I've sent you that'll help you out a little bit. Mike, I used your action music today when doing a session with Kyle to show how I blew out from short score to orchestral score. And Kyle was like, dude, that action cue the guy wrote it is legit. And then when I blew it out and showed you the tricks that I did, he was like, oh man, this sounds so great. Once you do the scrubbing string, he goes, it already sounded great as a piano, but then when you put the scrubbing strings in, you need to double the octaves. And I was like, yeah, man, I was like, this was good. So you're famous in the EIS community. I'm using your eight bars as like, not instructional material, but like showing how you can go from short score to, that was Mike Elways. Yeah, it was really good. He's a graduate of TSC. So everything comes back. Yeah, right? It was really good. It was a really good little eight bar thing. So let's listen to this and see how, once again, the octatonal scale, which gives you chords that are tritone apart and minor thirds, is showing up. Right there. Like that is literally two chords an octave apart, or a tritone apart. So it's like, in this case, I played G, D flat. That's all it is. And everyone's like, well, how are those things related? Well, they're related to the octatonic scale. Don't worry about Roman numerals. Like, this is where you have to ditch the Roman numeral shit. You can't do that. You gotta, that kind of stuff. You know, it's chord relationships that are based upon overtones and intervals and scales that are built. So. There's those double stroke strings, Kyle, right? The double. My God, that Ardbeg is good. Now, if you look, much of where Alan gets his chaotic color is selectively doubling one or two moments in his licks. So you might be like, he might go, but maybe this part was just electric piano and piano. And then maybe on this one, he has his xylophone go bum bum. So it's like bum bum. And it's like, oh, it sounds so, you know, animated, you know, kind of like old school Disney animation. And it's like, yeah, what he did was he played the lick out and he had other colorful instruments hit notes of that to create these kind of, you know, oh yeah, or the trumpet tabs. Could it be bum? Maybe the trumpets go bum bum right there. So that like you've got the lick going in the keyboards and the trumpets are like bum bum. This is the way that Alan does a lot of more colorful orchestration, which is how he got Roger Rabbit, because he did this kind of stuff. So these are things to kind of think about. I mean, like, you know, we're all over the place. I'm all over the place with this. But now comes so now, of course, he's got his, you know, freaking this to him was Star Wars. This was the one. Like, there's a really famous moment where Steven Spielberg dropped in to a daily with, who was the director? Not Richard Donner. John, not Landis. Who was it? Whatever the director was. Who did Forrest Gump. And Spielberg was like, look, man, this is a big action adventure. You need like a John Williams style action adventure composer to pull this off. And they had begun recording some of Alan's stuff for it, and they had temped it into the dailies. And Spielberg was watching it with the director, Zemeckis, Robert Zemeckis, thank you so much. And he said, and it was like the skateboard chase. And he's like, yeah, this is the kind of music you got to find. You got to find the music. This is the kind of music you got to find a composer and score. And Zemeckis was like, yeah, this is from the recording session last week. This is the guy, and this is the score. And Spielberg was like, perfect. Like, because Spielberg is a music lover. Like, he actually tells a story when Williams was sketching Indiana Jones themes. And as a director, he's sitting here going, oh, yeah, I can remember when he did the second theme, the And he's actually whistling it. And I was like, dude, as a director, you're actually like hearing the themes and remembering. Well, of course, part of the testament is because it's freaking John Williams, who's so good at thematic writing. So now we're at the spot now. We've now started to see that when Alan wants to do action stuff, he's got this little bag of tricks, and it's not ineffective. It's actually highly effective. These little motivic nuggets that can be just moved around, some would say haphazardly, but if you know the octatonic scale, that's what he's playing with a lot in the 80s, which is, oh, I can do this. I can just move stuff around in a tritone or a third. I can use the octatonic scale to create these little ostinato-y licks. He does it in Predator. He does it in Back to the Future. But then he gets tagged with something new, which is he gets tagged with Forrest Gump. And this brings out the other part of him that we haven't heard in a while, which is the sweet, sensitive pop composer, you know? In a different octave. This is not hard, right? He did it in the high octave, he does it in the stop there for a second. I want to give you a really interesting thing that he does there. And then, Mike, I'll ask that a typical Alan Silvestri progression, because I'll answer that in a couple of ways. I feel good seeing it both. Let me answer the question with a question. Now, check this out. Let's start to think about, this is me projecting onto Alan Silvestri. So, you know, take that as it is. His progression is so beautiful. It's 1-4-5, right? Right? So it's 1-4-2-5-1. Super easy, right? Yeah. So what happens here, Grim, right? So he does this. So he's in the B section of his theme, right? At that point in time, up until that, about 1 minute and 20, he's all in the key of G. G da 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 C da 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 A da 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 A da, C with a D. Right? Transition to the relative minor, super easy. Ba da 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 C. Right? A minor, D7. Now, he does what James Horner does. It's one of my favorite tricks. He's finished in G. He's sitting on the D, which is the 5 of G. He starts the new iteration of the theme on the same note, but he makes it a new interval. So listen, here he is on G. It's so easy. He's in G. Palm. Da 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 da. He's in the cue of that D. D. Whoa, what just happened? The D becomes the new starting point. It's now the third of B flat. It's a sectional modulation, a third up. and it's gorgeous. And my buddy Rob and I used to joke about this, because whenever I would fake doing horror, that's exactly what I do. I would go and I would do that, and we'd all laugh because we all knew what was going on, which is you sexually move a third away. Right. And but here's the thing. How did I do that? I took that ending note of my melody and I looked at what it was. I was like, oh, it's a Kyle, go back to EIS. This is the five above my G. I'm going to start my new section with this being the three above the B flat. And that's how I can modulate, is I just, you know, now where does Alan get the idea of moving by a third? Hasn't he been moving by thirds for years now? Because he's been doing. So now, instead of just doing it as an octatonic gesture, he's doing it as a modulation technique, as a structural technique. Right? Yeah, Grim, you're not in the think space, and this isn't like, oh, you're not in think space, but I did a big lecture about motion by thirds and fifths, and I'm like, dude, this is like the bread and butter of like modern film music. Like, don't, like, there's a whole science behind it, and there's actually an acoustical, physical reason you want thirds and fifths in your motions, in your root tone motions. So, boy, what a great way to create a whole new section. Just do the whole damn thing again, but a third up, and use the ending note as the new starting point, and that'll tell you what to move to, right? I know. You're already getting a ton of, yeah, I know exactly, right? So, Mike Elway was like, oh, what are some typical Alan Silvestri progressions? Well, now we're into 80s versus 90s. In the 80s, Alan, with his Burly action scores, a lot of minor chords separated by a minor third. That kind of stuff. So I was moving E minor to G minor, E minor, like that kind of stuff, right? James, oh my God, I love it that James is here, because James is a sentimental composer, so this is gonna be right up his alley. So right off the bat, if you're dealing with 80s action adventure Silvestri that you want to do, absolutely start playing with the octatonic scale and chords in a minor third. I'm just gonna do this right now. Ready? That's Predator right there, right? Like I just did a giant stacked E minor chord and then just moved to G minor. And then here's the best part. What he'll do sometimes is he'll go up one time and then he'll go down one time. So we'll do E minor up to G and then E minor down to C sharp minor. Always minor to minor. Now I'll repeat it by going down. Isn't that cool? So once again, but earlier on in my little Farkle Friday thing, I was saying that's what Alan will do, is he'll do it once one way and then he'll do it the other way, right? That's how he stretches an idea. So what did I do? I went E minor up a minor third to G, E minor down a minor third to C sharp. And people are asking, like, how did you write Vampires on a Boat so fast? I was doing shit like this because you just have to get through it. Of course, it's a third. Cheeky little sausages, and he. Oh, Tim! What's up, Tim? What's up, brother? Yeah, I'm really pimping out TSC. Dude, TSC's fun, man. We have great composers there, and we have some great content. And we have a lot of me ranting and drinking hard, which hopefully won't get me in trouble. So now we're at 90s Silvestri. 90s Silvestri is different, because 90s Silvestri is, he's become more sweet and sensitive. He moves into his family adventure time period here. So we're going to do a little Forrest Gump. Then we're also going to talk a little bit about Richie Rich and his action adventure and Father of the Bride. He has, he's really fallen into the sweet emotional core stuff, which funny enough is very, I don't mean simple because it is good jazz harmony, but it's obvious progressions. 1-4-2-5-1 is the Forrest Gump theme, with a beautiful set of notes that are supporting the chordal intervals. 3-4-5-5. Right? Real fast, I'm gonna answer these questions. TSC is awesome. Yes, it is. Lazar, how long did it take you to do Vampires in a Boat? I did it in 5 weeks. I did 60 minutes of full orchestral mock-up in 5 weeks. I wrote it and mocked it up in 5 weeks. It was good. I was proud of that. That's a good pace for an indie film composer. And it was good music. It wasn't just like it actually moved and actually had some orchestral development. Volcano. Yep. Darren, why down to C sharp, not C minor, movement by minor thirds? Because the octatonic scale, if you play the octatonic scale and you start building triads, the octatonic scale has minor thirds in it as part of the scale. So if you're moving by minor thirds harmonically, you're supporting the octatonic scale in the listener's ear. Yeah, Tim is here. The Mummy Returns has to have... Oh, yeah. Back to the Future, Predator, Forrest Gump, Mummy Returns, Ready Player One, and Avengers, and Night at the Museum. So we got a lot to do here. Will there be a soundtrack album? I don't know. I can't believe Netflix hasn't picked it up yet. Like they've been negotiating for like a year and a half. I was like, dude, come on. Netflix is like hurting, dude. Just like take this thing. It's just give me the goddamn credit. All right. So anyways, here we go. I'm gonna have to do a Farkle Friday. I'm like motivic. I'm like writing with motives, because if you listen to Alan's stuff, it's all motivic. Like it's, but this is not a cut on him. It's like, this is brilliant. Like just freaking take this idea. Right? Like you could just take this little figure, which is usually a shape and a couple of rhythms, and you just keep on translating it over and over again, and everything is connected. All right, I'm doing that at some point, because it's ridiculous. People should be writing motivically. It's just like, because you get shit like this, which is gorgeous. All right. Yeah. All right, let's do You Can't Sit Here, because that makes me cry, because it's so freaking sad. Oh my God, if you ever listened to Mr. Holland's Opus, this is like right in the same world as Michael Kamen, but yeah. Once again. Jesus, Alan, dude, this is a really good cue. Real fast, he's playing jazz extensions. So what that is it's an A minor on the bottom, and he's playing B, C, and then a B, B, G. So it's the ninth and the minor seventh. Which is the reason it's similar is Mr. Holland's Opus. There's something called Rowena's Theme, which is like... something like that. And oh yeah, score for Lilo Stitch is phenomenal. Dude, let's talk about how prolific Alan is. Like I haven't even gotten through half the stuff yet. We're already like an hour and a half in. It's like this guy writes and he writes everything. It's because we just heard his action adventure from the 80s. All right, awesome. Now we're doing a character piece where it's like super nostalgic and romantic and sentimental, and he's nailing that. We haven't even gotten to his family adventure, Night at the Museum, Richie Rich, and then we have to get his superhero shit, which is the Avengers stuff, right? And like, I mean, Jesus. And then he pastiched, what's his face, Bernard Herrmann in What Lies Beneath. It's like, fuck, man, he's good. Yeah, and the 70s TV stuff, right? Yeah, man. You know what? The more I gotta confess up here for a second. I used to feel guilty that I was like liking to write like Alan Silvestri, because I was like, well, everybody writes like Alan Silvestri because that's the sound, and like, you know, that's just me copying him and not actually being innovative. And as I get older and I don't care anymore, I'm like, but I've always loved Alan. Like, I always say like, oh, I'm a big Jerry Goldsmith, which I am. I'm a huge Jerry Goldsmith fan. But when I start looking at the scores that I've listened to and fallen in love with when I was in the 80s, probably as many of them are, if not more, are Alan Silvestri as they are Jerry Goldsmith. And so part of me is like, oh man, you know, like I probably am writing as much like Alan Silvestri as I am like Jerry Goldsmith, which is fine. And part of me is like, well, I can't do that because it's been done before and he does it. And now I'm like, I don't care. He's really good. Like, he's really good and he does it so well. You know, just embrace the fact that like I like Alan Silvestri and I want to write like him. Yeah, man. Well, yeah, James, you missed it. We did Predator a little bit earlier. We did the Burly stuff. His fucking brass writing. If you want to write fat action brass, like look at Predator. That's a go-to. Jeez, really good string writing. He actually writes really good string stuff too. What restraint. Also, This is a classic, but yeah, he's very, very, because of his jazz background, he's very aware of how beautiful those extensions are. So that moment with the strings where he was like doing that kind of G to C. He's got the seventh, the ninth, and the seventh. Oh, poor thing. Ripley's losing her shit. Cause it's thundering here, and she gets really worked up over thunder. Duke doesn't care, but Ripley gets really fired up. You can probably hear it in the back of the poor thing. Those sevenths and ninths keep on showing up as a composer, James, to get that richness in your scoring. Don't be afraid to add those sevenths and ninths in what you're playing. It's really easy to get triadic. So here we are. So here I'm in G. And now I'm gonna go to C. But I'm gonna make sure that I'm really hitting the seventh and the ninth. The extensions never really work in your mock-ups, really. You know what? You might be over-doubling. You got to be careful with those extensions because I've definitely used extensions, no problem. I did it in that Star Trek cube that I played a couple weeks ago and they work fine. They work great. But what you have to do is you have to be like, don't play the non-extensions in the same octave. So if I'm here with the strings, like this, and I'm in this octave, don't then play the other chords look at the same thing, you know what I mean? Oh, this is so cool, man. Studio One is showing the freaking keyboard. Oh, I may have to use more Studio One because look, you can see what I'm doing. This is so cool. Mike C. Van Helsing's score is awesome, and I have a funny story to tell you about that. Alan got really pissed over the fact that he did Van Helsing as a score because he basically, and rightly so, was like, I accidentally created the modern trailer sound, and everybody did it. And it created that over-the-top hyped trailer sound that Alan then had to kind of keep on doing. And because he wanted to do these kind of more, you know, orchestrally pure, you know, kind of thing. But like, if you listen, this is the beginning of that hyped hybrid sound. Thank you. Yeah, that's it, Grim. I make sure I don't put it in the same octave. I drop it down an octave, exactly. Let's stop here. Listen, my ears get a little tired. This is funny because this is actually a great score. I love it. Guess what the chords are? It's huge and it's big, but guess what the chords are? G minor, up a minor third, to a B flat minor. Alan's nothing if not consistent. Nothing if not consistent. Come on, right here we go. So we're gonna deviate into Van Helsing for a second. First, I'm gonna answer some questions. Yeah, Grim, I leave an octave in between. Yeah. Hi, Michael. I've been watching your videos. The Studio One, your software from the beginning. I've switched. I'd love to hear your thoughts on Studio One. I'll answer that right now. I don't put it in the same octave either, but you put the chord even lower than I do. That's a conversation for a different time. Not I'm not trying to blow you off, Grim. I'm just like we have to go look at that and actually like space it out. We'll have to do a Farkle Friday review at that point. Sivir Makshiran. I'm so sorry. I'm mispronouncing your name. Yes, I have used almost every DAW. I've never composed directly in Pro Tools, but I've done mixing slash production with Pro Tools. But I was a Sonar. Well, I used everything. I was Cubase. I was Digital Performer. I was Reaper, which is surprisingly amazing. And I still keep Reaper as like my backup. And I was Sonar, and I loved Sonar. It was really amazing. And then that weird thing happened where Gibson bankrupted it. It got picked up by this like social media company, and I was like, I don't want my professional DAW to be run by a company that's doing like free to play kind of mechanics. I mean, they're apparently doing very well with Sonar. They're keeping it very fresh and whatever. So I was a Studio One beta tester for Studio One 3, and then I dropped it for Studio One 4 and came back at Studio One 5. So, I love Studio One. I think it's really, really good. There's some, you have to study it. Like I purchased the Groove 3 Studio, a couple of the Groove 3 videos, and I went through a lot of them, and I went through another one. Jesus, it's fucking raining. I love it. I think it's really, really useful and powerful. And there's some cool shit if you're getting into sequencing and programming. They've got a built-in drum sequencer where you can take any MIDI clip and flip it and it turns into a step sequencer. I mean, it's some cool shit. And they've got some strong macros. Their video stuff is okay. It's not great, but it's not bad. But I don't score in the DAW to video. I write a sketch to Sibelius and then I actually play it in, so it doesn't really bother me. How do I rank Pro Tools? It's an industry standard. Tim's gonna get mad at me when I say this. It's like, I don't know. It's fine. I think there's better software out there as a composer. I think if you're a mixing engineer, it's a pretty strong offering. If you're like running a mixing session, Mike Verda has scored feature films in Pro Tools, so it's got the MIDI capabilities. But I think I'm faster in Studio One. I think I'm faster in Reaper. I think that Pro Tools was great for its time, but it didn't evolve as well. I'm feeling the same thing about it. I think Avid's a fucking awful company because I can't stand Sibelius, so I'm bleeding over to Pro Tools. It's like they don't adapt with the times, and they're getting spanked on the butt repeatedly, right? It's like, yeah, it's like, look, why would I use it just because everyone else does? I want something that's going to work for me. Like, look, for example, the video game developers that I love, the guys, the video game audio gurus, a lot of them are Reaper hounds. They're just like, dude, this thing is so freaking, the shit they do in Reaper for sound design and for game audio is insane. Like, they're so fast. Their macros are insane. The things that they do, oh, yeah, it's like, And I like Studio One because it feels very musical. Like, I could actually just sit down in Studio One and just, like, if I wasn't trying to, like, be like a, detailed orchestral composure, although I've done detailed orchestral composing in it, and it's great. But if I'm like, can I just drag a couple of synths and a couple of drum kits in and start making some music? It's like, I'm up and running in 3 minutes, and it's like, woo, and it's fun. And then you're like, ooh, let me drag some effects in. I'm like, and it's just fun to write in Studio One, you know? Yeah, man, look, Pro Tools, oh. Yeah, dude, and that's the other thing. Everyone's like, well, Cubase. I'm like, yeah, well, Cubase is the little brother of Nuendo, which if you're in Europe, that thing is the Pro Tools. It's a beast. Like, Nuendo does, my buddy Alex Brandon uses Nuendo. He's like, dude, you don't understand how much this thing can do. It's a $2,000 piece of software. Hey, baby, oh, I know, Ripley's being all panicked because of the thunder. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. So anyways, yeah, that's the yeah, I mean, look, let me tell you what I did in Reaper, for example, that got me out of trouble in Vampires on a Boat. I had a script that was like, okay, I'd play like a string line, and I'd play like a string line like this. Let's say I was just doing a string line like this. I would just go, and by the way, you can do this in Studio One. I figured this out. I would go like that, right? I'd do something like that. I'd highlight the whole thing, and I'd do a macro that I built myself. And here's what the macro would do. It would quantize it, lock it to 16th notes, duplicate it, and drag the second 16th notes down by 20% velocity. So all of a sudden I would get, I would get double strokes, and it would take me about 20 seconds. Like, not even, like 8 seconds. It'd be like, play it in, highlight it, press the macro, these four things happen, and then you're good to go. And then you copy that into the violas and the violins, because when you're writing for this stuff, it's not about being realistic, it's about, like, getting the sound right. So you're doing, I was constantly doing things where I was like, Symphobia was layered with Adventure Strings, was layered with Adagietto to get that huge sound, and it was like, it doesn't matter, it was 500 violins playing one line, who cares. Dookie Doo, yeah. So yeah, it's and the community of Reaper is pretty bonkers. Like, people literally will go onto the forum and be like, hey, I want to do this, and somebody's like, oh yeah, I just wrote a script for you here, this is what it does, just do it. And they just wrote a script for you to, like, solve that problem. It's like, It's really cool. Studio One is also a very good community. Long and short is, I recommend trying Studio One and Reaper. Those two are great. So let's get back to Alan. Is that answer your question? Oh, and by the way, Studio One is a 30-day uncrippled demo. Just do it. Go do it. Spend a weekend. Watch a bunch of the YouTube videos of the Studio One channel. Start playing around. You will love it. I think it's phenomenal. Yeah. Grim is right. Look. Yeah, Studio One and Reaper are so much fun. They're great. And there was a period of time where they were really trying to play with Fmod to integrate into Fmod. So they I haven't played with Fmod because I have to do Weiss for ThinkSpace, because we're a Weiss certifier. But I think Studio One and Fmod play very well together, which is pretty crazy. So let's get back to this. All right, so here we are. So Van Helsing. Okay, so I want to jump into this because Van Helsing was Alan's move into the over-the-top trailer-esque film score, which, like it or not, he brought this into the game, you know? Everyone talks about, you know, Hans Zimmer's huge scores. Let's listen to this thing here. Alan brought that big, larger-than-life, hyper-produced sound that he then later used in Avengers. So here. Here's a critical part, because I was going to talk about this in Night at the Museum. Here's where Alan's vocabulary shifts big time. And that's why you have to differentiate. Yeah, we're going to listen to Mummy Returns. It's really good. Everybody, you have to differentiate. This is a big thing. This is why, Mike L., you were like, oh, what's an Alan Silvestri chord progression? I'm like, well, what era? Because at this time in the mid-2000s, he stopped using the octatonic scale for his harmonic progressions, and he went modal. So here in the Attacking Brides, he was doing this. He had this pulsing thing, right? And he was doing a B minor to a G, you know, inverse, right, like that, right? Like just this very modal. That's just like, oh yeah, I'm doing a B minor to an E minor or a B minor to a G major, you know, over a B pedal. So a lot of these more static motions. But when he moved to a new key area, he moved by minor thirds. So he literally went like this. Right. So the point is, he shifted his mindset from my local progressions are based on minor thirds, and he switched it over to when I move from this harmonic area to this harmonic area, it's going to be minor third. But inside this harmonic area, I'm modal. And you'll hear it in Night at the Museum because he does a lot of Dorian stuff. He'll do this. Now that's classic Dorian, but then maybe he's in G, maybe he'll then move to B minor. So this is a critical thing about Alan's sound. It shifted dramatically in the 2000s to a more modal sound where he's just doing these kind of like, right? Like that kind of flat 6, flat 7, 1 pop sound he brought back in an epic context. But when he's sectionally moving, like oh, I've done 16 bars and I'm going to move to a new key area, he's moving by minor thirds from these 16 bars are in C and this next section is in A minor. He got that from his 80s octatonic, but now he's bringing back all of his pop stuff from the 70s, right? And then those strings keep the beat. That he's kept that from Predator and Back to the Future, right? Like the only thing he's doing is he's maybe not doing like little like neighbor motion, but yeah, we're gonna do Mummy Returns in a sec. This is when he got into his epic scoring, which. Also, by the way, notice his use of a lot more heavy percussion, which you hear in Avengers big time. I just played a G minor to B flat minor. Dude, like all day long, he's playing minor thirds. And Alan can do that over a pedal. That works really well. That totally works because the pedal is just is anchoring it. All right, let's do the Mummy Returns. Lazar's gonna. All right, what are we gonna do here? We're gonna do we're in trouble. Let's do we're in trouble. Let's do my first bus rags. It's awesome. G minor. Are we hearing Shades of Predator? Boom. Da-dun, dun, da-dun. Little, tiny, bite-sized motives that are reused over and over again. Oh, he's using Phrygian because he's in Egypt, right, of course. So. Those chords right there were. They were literally G minor to B flat to G minor to B flat. I've now played that progression in like 4 different film scores he did. So. Repeat it up high in the ending trumpets. Like. Thank you. Did we hear the theme? You know, I call it the Goldilocks composing method, which is if you say it once, say it again, right? This is too hot, this is too cold, this is just right, move on. Say it three times. On to the next thing. It's such a great, great strategy. Like, it works. And it's fun. And it almost feels like you're cheating as a composer, right? Yeah, and by the way, how much fun is it to think about the fact that Jerry did Mummy 1 and Alan did Mummy 2, and you're like, these guys are both still in real good form, which, by the way, Rob Thomas knows this, my buddy Rob. I'm doing, over the summer, probably a three-part Jerry Goldsmith Farkle Friday, and I want to do it proper where I actually do some reductions and things like that, because he's so prolific, and he's gone through so many iterations that you just got to, like, kind of, you know, just break him down. But his 90s stuff, he was starting to wind down. He was still writing good stuff, but it wasn't as inspired as the 70s and 80s stuff. But The Mummy was a really pretty solid score of his. I think that he did quite an excellent job on it. Yeah, he's playing the minor one to the major four. Yeah, sorry, I was just kind of getting some chords in my head from that. And let's take away nothing from his orchestration, which and his contrapuntal development, which is super tight. One thing that we all get from watching me is when I say these things, oh, I'm like, it's so simple. He's playing with this minor third thing. It's not a dismissive context. It's in an admiration of the elegance. I'm like, this is just smart writing. Like, it's really smart writing, and it's efficient. It's loaded with emotion. It's full of all the subtle nuances. I mean, you know, getting into nuance is a whole other thing. But by the way, Kyle hit me up and then was like something about doing something with Brad. I got to get Brad back on. He and I got to fart around and talk about these little nuances, because it's not just about the chords. It's about, like, little filigrees of melody, bum bum, like these little motions. That a lot of that is what makes action adventure music really good, and that is not tough to do, but you kind of gotta, like, look at the score and know what you're doing to be like, where can I fit this in? Okay, I've got the trumpets, I can go better, like, it's, you know, but at a high level, these chord motions are very straightforward and they're satisfying. That's what it is. Alan is a satisfying composer. When you listen to your stuff, you're like, I want action adventure, I'm getting action adventure. I want maudlin heart music, I'm getting maudlin heart music. Which we're gonna do Father of the Bride next. It's so good. 5-6-5-7-1, there it was. A good score. Grim brought a good point. He said he doesn't wander around and stuff hits home even when it's stationary, but a lot of it is he's got these wonderful little motions. So if he's on like a... let's say he's on an A. He's not holding a chord. Oh, he's doing that little... And he's adding little motivic filigrees. Those little motions. These little neighboring motions. These little motions like there, they don't take away from the key area that you're in. Key meaning musical key, like you're in A. But there's enough motion that you're like, it's not just like, you know, that phase in the background real fast. But if you've got these little ostinato patterns that are like, which is a very clever way to create motion while staying in a key area that's both steady because it's on A, but interesting and propulsive because it's got that motion, you know? Jesus. I'm so glad Scott recommended this to me because I am reloading my Spotify. I'm gonna get some more Alan into my stuff because I was like, I've been listening to a lot of Jerry to try and kind of get his vocabulary into my writing, which is great. But I was like, you know what? I naturally like writing the way Alan does, so why not just frickin' do it? And I was like, well, I don't want to really back to the future because I'm trying to do something more contemporary. But then I'm listening to like Mummy Returns and Van Helsing, and I was like, oh, later Alan Silvestri's pretty good to write too, right? You know? Yeah. What's funny though, Grim, is that he's not a trailer music composer, but he said point blank, he's like, Van Helsing kind of kickstarted that trailer music sound that I didn't mean for it to. He kind of had like a little bit of morose guilt, right? Like he was like, I didn't mean for it to, but it kind of did. So he's not a trailer music composer, but go back and look at the trailers music that was coming out about a year after he wrote Van Helsing, and you're like, oh yeah, they were all inspired by Van Helsing. By the way, I want to stop because I have to leave in about 15 minutes and I want to get some for James. I want to get some Father of the Bride. But are you hearing that bump, da, 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 da? That's the same strategy used in Predator. Bump, 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 ba-da-da, dun, 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 ba-da-da, dun, dun. So, like, this is great, though, because it means that Alan's found a compositional strategy that he's using over and over again, and it's working. Does that make sense? Well, in the action stuff, yeah. Because remember, I was talking, like, if you look at my Farkle Friday thing, I was talking about Burly, Burly, Burly Brass. Like, Alan loves, it's probably from his jazz background. Like, remember, in jazz, you're writing for big band, you're writing for four trombones, four trumpets, five saxes at minimum. So it's like, now saxes aren't brass, but they kind of are. So it's like, you use just these huge, thick walls of sound. And he takes it in here. He's like, I want all the brass. You know, like you look at his Judge Dredd score and it's like three trombones, bass trombones, and a tuba. Then it's like four trumpets and I think eight French horns. Like that's huge. You know, it's just like, yeah, we may have to do Silvestri part two next week. You know what? Let's do that. You want to do part two? Because I still haven't done Ready Player One or Avengers. Let's finish with a little bit of Father of the Bride. And we're going to do a two-parter. Yeah, we should do a two-part two. But again, I'm just having fun just kind of like commenting on his traits and his tendencies. So let's do a part two next week, and then I'll do the fantasy one after that because this has been very inspirational. Thank you, everybody. This has been very inspirational for me. Like, I love Alan, and I kind of put him on the back burner because I'm like, well, he's an 80s guy. I need to like kind of hear more contemporary stuff. But, you know, listening to how he's evolved as a composer even just now, and I knew this stuff intellectually in terms of like, oh yeah, he evolved into Van Helsing and he got the big sound with Avengers, but now I'm hearing it with all of you guys and girls and I was like, oh man, he's really developed a sound that is so satisfying. So let's finish this. James, this is for you. This is for you, James. And by the way, there's so much Silvestri to go through. Think about this. He's done like half the work of Goldsmith. Because we haven't done Goldsmith early TV, Goldsmith 70s stuff, right? Like, yeah. It's just fun to listen to. It's just fun to fart around with. Oh, wait, that's right. Doesn't he play with Here Comes the Bride like all over the place with this? We're going to do part two because we have to do his Christmas Carol stuff because this is him, like, when he cribs existing stuff. But let's listen to a little bit of this stuff. Repeats it, but a third away. He's doing it again and again. Let's do Alan with the sweet. Oh, so delicate. The shakers. Here he is in 1991 still doing the shakers. Oh my god, are we hearing Romance on the Stone here? Because I am. No, Brad and I, we're going to do an April Fool's and we're going to do John Williams scores. We're going to do all the shit he was. We're going to do Images and Monsignor because he got nominated for a Golden Raspberry for Monsignor, which is great. Yeah, right, right, Kyle? All right, let's actually check out some of this Annie Asleep. Oh, well, let's do the Maudlin stuff to end up. Yes. Yes. Oh, come on. If you're not tearing up right now, you're a horrible person. That is lovely. More 80s. Kyle, it's the sax. And you know what? I don't care that it's like a little cheesy and a little mauve, but this is great shit. Is it me, or does Alan feel very comfortable writing for piano? I feel like Alan is very comfortable writing for piano as opposed to, I don't see John Williams writing piano themes like James Horner does. James is a huge piano guy where it's like, okay, but Alan is very comfortable writing for piano, which is pretty kind of cool. Yeah, it's funny because I don't think Jerry wrote for piano like that. He did Rudy. He did, you know. I don't know. We'll figure that out. But man, Al, you know what? We're gonna do part two next week. We'll do more. Yeah, well, John Williams loves his freaking 1 to minor 4-6, right? Just like... But it's funny, for a jazz piano player, he doesn't write for piano that much as the lead instrument. Like, in DT, there's the whole... That kind of stuff. But, like, James Horner will write, you know... Like, he'll write as, like, in the Rocketeer. Like if you go to the Rocketeer, you're like, oh, yeah. Look, here's the main theme, right? Ready? James Horner. Like, he's so up. Like, he's like, the piano is the instrument. Like, this is it. Everything else is just... Yeah, like you. James Horner is actually, I hate to say this because he is, I think, a very, very good composer. When I'm trying to lift / pastiche a composer, like, James Horner is one of the easiest ones for me to do. It's not that he's not good, it's that he's really obvious with what he does. It's like, oh, well, 80s James Horner. It's like, oh, okay, you want to do 80s James Horner? This is what you do. And by the way, I always this joke, I got to do a Horner thing at some point. I don't like James Horner's scores unless I love his scores. What I mean is, I'm like, I don't like James Horner's music that much. It's annoying. Like Apocalyptico is really stupid. And I brought off a bunch of other scores that are dumb. And then I'm like, someone's like, yeah, blah, 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 James Horner, you know, Star Trek 2. I was like, oh my God, that score is amazing. And then I was like, you know, and then like, da, 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 the Rocketeer. Like, oh my God, the Rocketeer is amazing. So so when I love James Horner, and I love James Horner, and I have like three of his scores, like Aliens, I'm like, holy shit, Aliens is good. Like, it's so good. Holy shit, Krull is amazing. Right? Like, but then there's Commando, and you're like, what the hell were you thinking, James? Like, what's going on there? Like, have you ever heard Commando? Let's see if you can, because this is the kind of shit he did. I have it over here. I actually fucking bought the score. Such a shame. That's for another time. We may need to do a, yeah, like this kind of shit, right? Like, look, this is the cue. Yeah, Land 4 Time is amazing. Five-O's American Tale is amazing. But this is a score? This is James Horner. What the fuck? Dude, could you be any lazier? Could you be any lazier? He just sucked up a minute's worth of music with literally a oh my God, he's repeating it! So lame. And then here's his action music, right? Wow, I'm not liking this. I don't like the score at all. Oh, Lindrum for the win. Grim nailed it. Grim was like, hey, what are some examples of scores where you just write it for the money? Here's one. Here's one. Yeah, Field of Dreams is beautiful. We'll do a Horner one at some other point. It's funny. Look, and this is here. I'm going to wrap up because not because I don't love you guys, but because I actually have to get over to my mom's for a low D for douchebag. This is neither here nor there. This is not. Don't read into this at all. I feel like, you know, there was a really nice time period where Mike Verda was very, very active. And it's not that he's not active in a bad way. It's like, you know, things move on, this, that, and the other. But I feel like there's a bit of a hole. Mike Verda always brought, I think, a very entertaining, but also intellectually concise and precise analysis and deconstruction of various film score techniques and various compositional techniques. And I feel like it sounds kind of arrogant when I say this. I feel like Mike's kind of like stepped back a little bit. He's not doing it quite as much as he was before. And I feel like I'm kind of doing some of that stuff. I don't want to sound like I'm arrogant. Like I'm like there's a lot of other people that are doing it. Like Stephen Mellon's doing it. And some other, Austin Wintry has started talking about some things, and you know, he's got his shit together, which is awesome. But I feel like the reason I was saying that was, he did a Horner Mike Verda masterclass. You know, you can get it for whatever it is, like $30 or whatever. So I was like, oh, do I want to do one? I was like, well, you know, why don't I do my take on Horner? Because why not? It's a lot of fun. And if nothing else, we can listen to a whole bunch of really good James Horner cues and enjoy the stuff that he did very, very well. Because it's like the old nursery rhyme, right? Like, there once was a girl with a little curl right in the middle of her forehead. When she was bad, she was very, very, when she was good, she was very, very good. And when she was bad, she was horrid. And I feel that way with James Horner. It's like, when you're good, James, you're like legendarily good. Like Field of Dreams, Braveheart, Star Trek II, The Rocketeer, Krull, Aliens. When you're bad, when you're doing Chud and like Commando and Apocalyptica, I'm like, you're really bad. Like, you're just so just whatever. So anyways, Yeah, that's true. Grim's like, at least you pinged the At least you ping the goalpost, right? Either. You're right. You know? So why don't we do more Silvestri next week? Just for fun. We'll have a little listening session. We'll finish up with the later Silvestri because I really wanted to look at two things. One is his later bombastic epic stuff, like A-Team, G.I. Joe, Avengers, where he's kind of firmly into that kind of super hyped orchestra sound, but he's doing not the Hans Zimmer remote control thing. He's still kind of got his aesthetics. And then also a couple of fun little like pastiches, like his Cosmos or his What Lies Beneath, where he's doing kind of like a Jerry Goldsmith Star Trek thing for Cosmos, and then What Lies Beneath, he's doing a big Bernard Herrmann pastiche. The portals. Oh, are you talking about the portal scene in Avengers Endgame where they all come back in? Yeah, he shit the bed on that one. Let's tear him down. Let's, you know. The funny thing is, oh, he's not in LA. He's out in LA. I was like, he's out in the East Coast. He could drive down and like punch me in the face and be just like, what are you talking about? So anyways, that's, that's the Farkle Friday for today. A little Silvestri. Now, last thing before I go, by the way, what Silvestri scores, if I'm doing fantasy, should I download onto here? Because I grabbed Van Helsing and The Mummy Returns. Those were good ones that were very Silvestri. What else should I load to start listening to again with new ears? Last chance, everybody. Yeah, Silvestri Part 2. And then we'll do a little Farkle. I'll get Brad and we'll do another Farkle roast. And then I have to do a fantasy music one, which is going to be a lot of World of Warcraft. Like, I'll dive into that. Maybe I'll get Jason to come in and talk about that, because he actually worked on one of the World of Warcraft albums. He's a Hollywood orchestra. He's really, really good musician. Really good jazz composer, too. Yeah. All right, so last thing. What should I download for that? I just downloaded Van Helsing and Mummy Returns. Yeah, I'll do Thomas Newman. Beowulf, right? He did that one. That was good. Yeah. Kolasar. Thomas Newman's fun. But do we want to do like older Thomas Newman, like American Beauty, or like stuff like Shawshank, Road to Perdition? We'll do them all. We'll just play around with it. But hey, but you know what? Captain America's good. That one's good. Avengers, I think, is really good. It's more heroic. I'm trying to get more fantasy stuff, so maybe Night at the Museum. But what have we learned from today? That Alan has a couple of favorite scales and favorite chord relationships derived from those scales, and he's able to use them over and over and over again. We've learned that Alan writes Burly Burly Brass by taking triadic structures and doubling them in octaves, and he builds it. So if you look at the score, it actually looks like this. It'll be like, ba-dun-dun-dun-dun, like that. And it's like so easy. Yeah, Larry Carlson. Wait, who's Larry Carlson? Why am I? Hey, let me check it out here. Yeah, Wally. If we're doing Wally, we're going to do a Peter Gabriel breakdown. Shawshank, Nemo's fantastic. Let me look up Larry Carlson. Because I'm thinking of Larry Carlton. Send some links. Well, Grimm. And your point is totally right with the Wagnerian voice leading. And this is not me throwing it back into the EIS thing. Like, Wagner, once he started to avoid the 1-5-1-1-4-5-1-1-2-5-1 thing and started seeing as like any chord can lead to any other chord, he started seeing where can I voice lead to get the smoothest voice leading possible, which is a very jazz thing. And when I started EIS, that to me was, I was like, oh, this is just a logical way of like, I'm in C and I need to get to A flat. What are the closest motions I can make to get there? Because I'm not worried anymore about circle of fifths or circle of fourths. I'm just worried about, I want to be from C to A major, or C, that C moment to that A moment. And then how can I get there? So yeah, there's a lot of Wagnerian stuff. It's definitely derived from jazz. And you know, it was Larry Carlton. Okay, I was right. It was not Larry Carlson, Larry Carlton. Got it. Yeah. Cool. All right. Well, listen, everybody, go have a lovely day because it is a lovely day. And yeah, Larry Carlton's great, man. He's out of Steely Dan. He's amazing. I'm going to go hang with my mother and my girls, and you all have a great day. Thanks for this trip into a surprisingly fun. Well, it's always fun, but I kind of threw it together at noon today because Scott was like, hey, do an Alan Silvestri thing. I was like, all right, I'll talk about it because I've been looking at him the last couple of weeks. And yeah, everyone have a great week. I'll see you next week for Farkle Friday. We'll kick off Memorial Day with more Alan Silvestri, and then, I don't know, we'll just go from there. You know, I've got some ideas. And everybody, go listen to some Alan Silvestri and have a great weekend. God bless you all. I'll see you all in 7 days for the next Farkle Friday. Later.